Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. For nearly four centuries, it has been an icon of American agriculture. But now, the Tuttle Farm in Dover, the oldest family farm in America, is up for sale. That sale has raised some questions about the future of the family farm, especially one so steeped in history. It all began in 1632 with a small grant of land, 20 acres in Dover, given by King Charles to John Tuttle. Tuttle proved lucky. His ship was wrecked, but he survived to claim his land and found the oldest surviving family farm in the nation. Over the centuries, the farm grew and prospered.
It's always been really lucky that someone has wanted to stay on. I'm sure that, you know, the first, second, third, fourth generation, you know, everybody just stayed where they were during those times in the 1600s and 1700s and so on. And there was always somebody who wanted to continue because, you know, that's what you did. You all lived together in one house and everybody went out and did the work, and the youngest son, or at least one of the sons, would be there to carry on. I'm sure nobody ever said, we are going to be here for 11 generations, isn't that cool? And in fact, it really wasn't until my grandfather's time that there was any particular recognition of the fact that, wow, we've been here for a long time.
Lucy's grandfather, William Penn Tuttle, was the ninth generation. Under his leadership, the farm greatly expanded to over 200 acres. It had become a local institution, and some of its children began to wander. You lived in France for 7 years. How did you end up back on the farm?
Well, I'll tell you, I ran away and really didn't want to be down on my hands and knees picking anymore. I had done that enough, I thought, during my childhood growing up here. But as the time went on in France, I realized that I really had something special. Most of the people that I knew did not have something to go back to. And as I got older, I began to value that more and came back and spent a couple of months here and there, mostly in the summer, and really began to feel the pull of my heritage and a real wanting to be here with my family.
And so Lucy and her brother Will returned in the 70s, just as their father Hugh, the 10th generation, was considering closing down the farm. It was a big story in a national magazine, and the brother and sister worked on modernizing the farm for another 40 years. Adding this very high-end farm stand.
So when you look out here and think about this no longer being yours, what's your feeling?
It's very surreal. I can't even begin to express what it feels like. I can't imagine it not being ours anymore. It's going to be something that will take some definite getting used to. You know, I grew up here. All my memories are here, or most of my memories are here. I spent the last 40 years working here. And in the last couple of years, I've spent some time working outside on my days off from the store. And it's just been very wonderful to be out in the peacefulness and, you know, thinking, boy, right here where I'm standing now, my father stood and did the same thing that I'm doing, and my grandfather stood and did it, and his father, and so on all the way back. It's an amazing feeling of connectedness and purpose and really quite a wonderful sense that you get of continuity and so on.
And joining our panel here at the Red Barn store at the Tuttle Farm, we have Lucy Tuttle, who is a co-owner of the farm. We have Lorraine Merrill, who is the New Hampshire Commissioner of Agriculture. And we have Dave Tuttle, who is the owner of the Riverside Farm in Maine, but I should also add, a cousin of Lucy's. Welcome, all of you.
Thank you.
Well, Lucy, the farm itself actually nearly closed some 40 years ago, didn't it?
I think that our father considered selling the farm back in maybe the early 1970s. Times were tough then, as they are now, and as they always are for farmers. And he was around 50 years old, and I think that he was feeling as though the farm had run out of Tuttles. We were all, my brother and sister and I, were off doing other things. And then, lo and behold, we came back.
From Paris.
Here we are. Here we are. What can we do?
So what sort of changes did you make at the time to, you know, revive it?
Well, I think we brought energy, new energy, youthful idealism, mm-hmm. and a sense of purpose. You know, we were very excited about growing new crops. We started getting more into the greenhouse end of the business, and I had spent some years in Europe and eventually managed to sneak some cheeses into the store, which led to a whole plethora of gourmet goodies that were not really available in this area at that time.
So what's different this time around?
I don't know. I never say never. The farm is for sale. The business is for sale. We do have children. We cannot predict or know what they're going to do necessarily. None of them is a farmer. There are none of them out there working on the farm right now. They certainly feel very connected to the place. And, I can't say for sure what might happen in the future. But for now, we are in the position that our father was in back in 1970. We are considerably older than he was then. And just feel as though we need to slip out of the harness and put ourselves out to pasture and give somebody else a chance at doing this.
Well, Dave, you know, obviously I'm a member of a different branch of the family, but you also have your own Tuttle family farm.
Yes, we do.
It's considerably younger, right? It's only, what, 200 and...
We've been there since 1743, so they have 111 years on us. So.
What is the present for your farm? Are your kids an active part of it? Does it look like it will continue?
Well, our situation is quite similar to this operation, really, on a smaller scale. My wife, Lorraine, and I were in the same position that they are in now because we, probably about 5 or 6 years ago, we were thinking the same thing. You know, we don't have the children coming back to the farm, and we didn't know really what the future of the farm was going to be. And then all of a sudden, we got the knock on the door, too. Our daughter, Michelle, and her husband talked to us about coming back to the farm, and I thought they were crazy. They both had very good paying jobs and doing very well, but they wanted the farm lifestyle. And so they talked to us, and we agreed, yes, we'll bring you on to the farm, and we'll work you in and see what happens. Our son, Jason, came back to the farm. He had gone to college, got a degree in engineering, went to work for a very good corporation, making good money, and now he's back at the farm. What the lure is, I guess it's the way of life. It certainly isn't a high-paying job, but I think the way of life is what's lured them back.
Well, Commissioner Merrill, how common is this sort of situation with family farms? We know it's both an icon, if you will, of American life and history, but also a lot of pressures on families to run farms.
That's absolutely right, Richard. And I think that the outpouring that we've seen of response from people when they've read this news in the newspapers and so forth, it's because it represents so much to people. At this point, fewer than 2% of our population is actively involved in production agriculture, but a much larger percentage is just one generation, two generations, three generations removed. And I think this has brought to people's consciousness their own perhaps past ties to a family farm and what was lost. It's almost like there's a grieving process going on, not only amongst the customers and the residents of the Seacoast area, for which this farm is just an icon or true landmark, but from a much wider, even nationally, if you Google this right now.
You know, you got a huge amount of attention when this story broke. In the New York Times, CBS, ABC, I think half the reporters on the planet were chasing you about this.
They still are.
And they still are, excuse us. But what do you think it is about this story, at the heart of this story, that really touched that nerve that made people take such an interest?
Well, I think it's what Commissioner Merrill says. I think we are a nation of farmers at heart, and everybody can relate to this story. You know, they may have had immigrant grandparents who were farmers, or, you know, everybody feels a little bit of a connection to the land, I think. You know, people like to have their own home gardens. People certainly love to eat fresh fruit and vegetables in season.
Well, is it an impossible question, Dave, to say what is it you like about farming? Is it the big paycheck you get at the end of each week?
Well, Richard, we know that's not true. It's the love of the land. It's the love of what we do. With us having the family back on the farm, that's a big plus for us, to be able to go out and just share the knowledge that I have of farming with my family, with our grandchildren, and having them there with us, sharing our business. There's ups and downs. On good days, they're there to share it with us. And on bad days, they're there to support us. So it's really hard. I think the love of land is huge for us and what we do. Be able to grow crops and produce good food for people. People appreciate that. We get a lot of comments from people that appreciate what we do and support us. And I think that's a huge part of why I love farming.
Farmers have to be the world's greatest optimists. You know, you put a seed in the ground and you just have faith that it's going to grow and it's going to provide you with something wonderful to eat, something wonderful to share with your family.
Tell me about, you had mentioned among the large number of very personal reactions that you got, the letter that you got from that gentleman.
I received a letter last week from a gentleman in California with no return address. It was addressed to John and Lucy Tuttle. I think he had the generations mixed up, but how fitting that he should include the first Tuttle and maybe one of the last Tuttles to be here on the farm. It was written in pencil on the back of the form that you get at a pharmacy that tells you about drug interactions. And enclosed in the envelope were four $1 bills. And this person was a man because he signed it Ed. This person said, I'm not a money sort of person, but I heard your story and I wanted to do what I could to help. I wish I could do more. You know, that's the most precious $4 I have ever seen. And I wish that he were not anonymous. I wish that I knew who he was and could contact him.
You know, the size of the operation, we should say, here is just under 200 acres, but it's a pretty big one. You have a pretty big retail operation here. Is this just a little too big, maybe, for a family farm?
I think it is. I think that's one of the issues. We're a medium-sized, small farm. We're not small enough to be run by a family unless we had more children than
many children
and grandchildren and so on. And it's too small to be mechanized really in any significant way. So we have the overhead of labor and all of the costs that go along with that.
Would this, though, do you think be too small for the big ones, like the corporate type operation?
Well, this is a very, this farm in the middle size is the real challenge in America, not just here in New England, but in the whole country. And those are the farms that are most threatened because they don't have the huge size and all those economies of scale and mechanization. And yet they are not so small that they can be easily supported by outside income. I mean, what we're talking about really with these middle-sized farms is full-time farm occupations, you know, people who are really trying to support their families from the farm, not as a supplemental second income or...
Well, we've seen a wide variety of things that you produce here, whether it be the crops or the wood, the firewood, stuff like that. Dave, you were mentioning too that your farm had undergone a transition from being mostly wholesale to mostly retail.
That's correct. A number of years
ago.
What
difference did that make?
Well, it made a huge difference. We were, we had talked earlier about, we were about 85% wholesale and about 15% retail, and we turned that around. That was by design. We wanted to do more with the retail, so we built a bigger stand, and my wife and I really concentrated on trying to do more with the retail, and now we're about 90% retail and about 10% wholesale. And that's a good balance for us, I think. We like some of the wholesale, but the retail is really where the money is. Certainly presents bigger challenges, a lot more overhead, having a farm stand, having the labor, having the all the expenses that go with retail. It certainly is a challenge, and a lot more demanding because retail is every single day. and the wholesale might not have been every day. But it has been a good change for us, and we've expanded our stand mainly because the business demanded it. People wanted more from us. We built bigger greenhouses, more greenhouses, and just went into, we have a commercial kitchen now, and my wife Lorraine, last year, she baked 5,000 loaves of bread, 2,500 chicken pot pies, thousands of jars of jams and jellies. I mean, that's just a part of what we do. And people demanded that. That's what they wanted. So we listened and we did what we had to do.
You look to see whatever works, I guess, in essence.
This has been key to New Hampshire and New England agriculture surviving. We're tops in the country for the percentage of farm sales that come from retail and so forth. And it's absolutely essential because our costs are much higher here in New England, which is the pressure that our farmers are really under.
So I guess you would also have to say that being a farmer, whatever stereotypes to the contrary, is actually a complex task. I mean, you've got a lot of different aspects of your operation to deal with. I mean, how would you, all three of you are farmers, how does it compare to, let's say, being an accountant?
I don't know. I've never been an accountant before. I have trouble balancing my checkbook.
Remarkable about farmers, I was once told that a major construction company here preferred to get former dairy farmers as project managers because they could manage multiple systems and multiple operations like no one else. And that's kind of what you have. You have to be a business person, and you have to work well with people, manage people, the public, and you have to know all this science, technology. It's
that's a strong bag.
I'm glad you mentioned the business aspect, because farmers have to be business people.
Absolutely.
We have to be businessmen. I mean, you know, we have to know how to do the books. We have to know how to manage people, how to hire, and how to work with people. And there are so many aspects of farming that we have to know. It's a learning experience all the time. You never know everything about farming. We learn all the time.
And no season is like another.
Every season is different. You have to adapt.
So when you look at a situation like that where the family farm is up for sale because it's just not tenable the way things are going right now, what does that overall do to agriculture itself as yet more of the market inevitably probably gets shifted towards larger, more corporate concerns?
Well, it's hard to know. It's certainly a message that people who care about having farms as part of their communities need to support them while they have them. And we have many, many farms in our state. We've actually had an increase in the number of farms. We've had new farms starting up. There's another farm over in Walpole, which is the also one of the oldest farms in the country, has been, I think that's on their 10th generation. They only started in 1761.
Well, you know, when you look at the price of land, though, it must be staggering, the thought of actually starting up a new farm and not inheriting it.
Many of these new farms are starting on rented or borrowed land, and trying to buy the land is the real hurdle for people to get over, to buy a farm. You're right. It's huge. It's a tremendous capital investment, and so you need to, that's why people need to understand, in terms of supporting their local farms, local food is not going to be cheaper, and there's a reason for that, because our costs of land and energy and everything else are so high in this region.
Now, we should make it clear that there is a conservation easement, is it?
Yes.
On the land you have here. So that means that even if it passes out of your family, this has to remain farmland?
Yes, it has to remain in agricultural use or as open space. It cannot be developed. And that is...
And you sold those rights not long ago, right?
5 or 6 years ago, yes.
Well, why did you decide to do that then?
I beg your pardon?
Why did you decide to give up the rights to... I mean, you've got beautiful land in a largely residential area that I'm sure could make space for hundreds of homes.
Well, I think you've just answered the question.
Okay.
That's not something that we wanted to see here. And I think that it would have been just unimaginable to think about selling this place if it were going to be developed. Just, we could not.
do that?
Ever been tempted to?
We have been approached. There's a program in Maine, similar to what Lucy's talking about. We've been approached. We've looked into it. We're in a little different situation than Lucy right now because we do have family members coming back. So we know that the farm is going to stay in agriculture for a while. That might be something that our children might want to look into. But as far as us right now, we know the farm is going to stay in agriculture. We don't think that it's the right time for us to consider selling the development rights on the farm.
You know, Lucy, I have to ask, given where you're headed, is what would be your advice to young farmers?
Wow. I would say to...
Don't be old farmers, perhaps?
Well, that might be one of them. I would say to find a niche that works for you, to see what the demand is out there in the world and try to fulfill people's needs. I think that we did that for a long time and that maybe we stepped back a bit from doing that in recent years. And it always pays to listen to what people want.
What were the many steps that you took along the way? Because you've done many different things here that you discovered later maybe you shouldn't have done. I mean, this is much bigger than your average farm stand,
yes,
obviously.
Yes. At the time when we built this addition onto the old red barn, we had totally outgrown our space. There was a huge demand for the sort of things that we were carrying in a very small space. And we, I think, overestimated in the long run what kind of space we were going to need. And, I think it's a good idea to stay small, to stay as small as you possibly can. That would be my advice, I guess. Don't overextend yourself.
You know, this is New Hampshire Eat Local Month, August. And there is a special weekend, August 28th to 29th, is the Passport to New Hampshire Farms weekend, where we have, I don't know, like 60 farms all around the state that will be open to visitors on both Saturday and Sunday. You can get a passport if you go to www.nheatlocal.org. You can print out a passport and take it, and if you get the stamps at I think it's 3 or 4 farms, then you can send in your passport to the Department of Agriculture and be entered in a drawing for a prize. And another way that people can support the local farms we have here in New Hampshire and New England, actually, is to go to www.keeplocalfarms.org, which is geared to supporting dairy farms. For people who want to support their local agriculture here in New Hampshire and New England, we have ways.
Well, we're just about out of time, but Dave, as someone who is staying in agriculture, what's your advice to young farmers?
Well, I think Lucy has a good point. You have to find what works for you. I think we have new blood on the farm. I'm listening to them. They seem to have a finger on the pulse of what people want. There are some changes on our farm. It's been interesting. I've had to change, and I think that's it. You have to really find out what people want, and try to meet that need, that demand. There is a huge movement for eat local, buy local, and we're riding that wave right now. And I think that's helping local agriculture a great deal. People want to know their farmer. They want to know where their food is coming from. They feel it's safer and it's fresher. And I think that's a key to young people. Let's find out what the people want and give them what they want.
As we can see right in the center of our table here, I thank you all for joining us. Lucy Tuttle, Lorraine Merrill, and Dave Tuttle. Thank you. I'm Richard Ager, and we'll see you next time on New Hampshire Outlook.